Sweden, Portugal, Stalin's USSR, Mao's China, Revolutionary Catalonia, Norway. All have been described as socialist at different times and by different people. And this causes a lot of problems for us when we're trying to understand what the word socialist means. The word has about 20 different meanings, depending on who you're talking to, generally loosely connected to the idea of worker ownership of the means of production. But it's important to state from the outset that there is no one perfect, universally accepted definition of the word. It's always been a contested term. Following on from this, I can't claim to speak on behalf of social democrats, anarchists, or any kind of right-winger, but what I can do is provide a Marxist-Leninist and Marxist-Leninist-Maoist understanding of it. So, let's find out. What is it from our perspective? Welcome to Socialism 101, a series designed to help educate people with no prior knowledge on the basics of socialism and communism from an explicitly Marxist-Leninist and Marxist-Leninist-Maoist perspective with short and easily digestible videos. If this sounds interesting to you, then go ahead and hit subscribe and turn on the notification bell below. First and foremost, we view socialism as a stage of historical development. Specifically, the transitional stage between capitalism and communism. Earlier in the writings of Karl Marx, what we're now calling socialism would have been referred to as lower stage communism, while what we've been referring to as communism would have been higher stage communism. It's really from Lenin onwards that we arrive at this tidier separation of the historical stages into capitalism, then socialism, then communism. Now, as socialism is a transitional stage, it's a bit unstable and prone to backsliding into capitalism. In the socialist transition, you're either continuing the class struggle and moving forward to communism, which we call the socialist road, or you're abandoning the class struggle and backsliding into capitalism, the capitalist road. Importantly, you may reach a stage where you find that you've eliminated classes on paper within your country. Everyone is now legally working class or proletarian. But what about the illegal capitalists on the black market? What about those who've joined your leading communist party but have lingering capitalist ambitions and are working to restore capitalism? What about the bourgeoisie in the surrounding capitalist countries that are trying to destabilize your socialist country? Well, to combat these, we not only continue the class struggle under socialism, but in fact intensify it. And this class struggle continues until classes have been abolished all over the world, when we can finally move to a fully communist, stateless, classless, moneyless society. As much as we'd love to just hit the big red global communism switch, that process doesn't happen overnight, but is much more likely to take centuries to fully complete. Now, let's dial it back a bit and look at the main features of socialism from the ML and MLM perspective. We can loosely group these features under three main categories: the economic aspect, the political aspect, and the transformational aspect. Economically, socialist countries operate under the instruction from each according to their ability to each according to their work. You see the transformation from a capitalist society led by the anarchy of the market with its boom and bust cycles into a rationally planned centralized economy. This of course eliminates problems like wasteful overproduction as we move towards primarily producing for use rather than production for profit. We see the transformation from private ownership of the means of production to public or state ownership, including nationalizations and collectivizations, under which you gradually see more direct worker control over the means of production develop over time. You also of course have cooperative ownership. And the trajectory for all of these is to progressively transition to the full communal ownership of communism. However, and this is important, this can only help to advance us closer towards a stateless, classless, moneyless society when it's led by the political power of the working class. Which brings us to the second category, the political aspect. Under capitalism, we live under the dictatorship of the bourgeoisie. This means that the capitalists are in charge, that they're the ruling class, whether that's under a liberal democracy or under outright fascism. Socialist societies are politically led by the working class and its genuine representatives. This is called the dictatorship of the proletariat. Yeah, I know, we need a less scary sounding name for it. This is why you'll usually hear us saying something like working class governance instead these days. The governing body must at all times act in the genuine interests of the working class. How do we ensure that the leading communist party doesn't just become a group of power-hungry elitists disconnected from the masses not representing the people? Easy. The leading party stays firmly connected to the masses through the mass line organizational methods. And if the leading party steps out of line, taking the people down a reactionary path, then the empowered masses rise up against the party itself as part of the cultural revolution that sets it back on the revolutionary communist path. Alright, maybe we're getting a bit ahead of ourselves here. Links below for more on those. Finally, the third category is the transformational aspect. Socialism is the transitional stage between capitalism and communism. At all times, the society must be progressing from capitalism towards a stateless, classless, moneyless society. This includes transformation of the relations of production by abolishing the capitalist class, advancing towards the full abolition of the commodity form, winding down production for exchange and phasing out the capitalist law of value, progressively abolishing markets, eliminating wage labour, abolishing private property, moving production to public or cooperative property of the dictatorship of the proletariat, and eventually fully communal property as the capitalist class is abolished, and maintaining the socialist road to communism through cultural revolution, or rather, multiple cultural revolutions. Some, including Marx himself, also talk about the need for labour vouchers rather than money as we currently understand it in this transformational period, so as to prevent circulation, that MCM capitalist circuit discussed in a previous video, the free purchase of labour power and the means of production, etc. When assessing whether or not a country is socialist, we have to consider all three of these aspects, the economic, the political, and the transformational. If it doesn't satisfy all three, we don't consider it socialist. Even societies under the political leadership of a dictatorship of the proletariat that are actively building and transforming themselves towards socialism aren't necessarily socialist until they've also satisfied the economic aspect. See, for example, the New Economic Policy, or NEP period, of the USSR after the Bolshevik Revolution, which was state capitalist due to its economic structure before the USSR became actually socialist a number of years later. Likewise, there was a state capitalist period in China after the revolution which declared the People's Republic of China in 1949 before it became properly socialist a number of years later. Today we've looked at the Marxist-Leninist and Marxist-Leninist-Maoist understanding of socialism. It's comprised of three equally important and often overlapping aspects, the economic, the political, and the transformational. Without satisfying all three, we are unable to accurately describe society as socialist by this Marxist understanding. That being said, there are certain cases which are extremely clear-cut examples of socialism, like the post-NEP USSR, while there are also many other societies where the legitimacy is genuinely socialist according to these three categories is still fiercely debated among MLs and MLMs. Next up, we'll be diving back into the relations of production as we finally flesh out the answer to the question, what is class? Thank you for watching this video, hopefully you found it useful in one way or another. I am struggling financially at the moment, so please consider donating €1 or $1 per month over on Patreon or a once-off donation over on Ko-fi. Links in the description box below. Thank you to Rare Hero, Cormac O'Brien, Dan Hunter, Red Corridor Roya, Christian Nepalis, Daniel H, MLM in Practice, Comrade Romano, Jason, Michaela Schmid, Mamarius Hex, Ryan Hodgson, Don Loquishleva, Gabriel Bailey, Lepanian, Hugh Jass, The Royal Way Condition, Jess, Ian McShay, Soup, Pontus, Colin Welch, Hagen Mitchells, Evan Crossland, Dot Dot, Borakua Gorilla, and Polster Roman. I wouldn't be able to make these videos without you. Cheers everyone, August Long Fall.